this episode will melt metal to make a piece for my motorcycle. Hi folks, I'm Custom Chess for Roma Custom Bike, and in this episode we're finally completing the Metal Foundry Project. In the previous episode, if you have missed it, please check the links in the description. I have built my new foundry using an IKEA vase, some sand, refractory mortar, and some steel wool. Then I tested it, and after a failure, I managed to finally melt some aluminum. Once I had enough, I made my very first muffins. Aren't they pretty? I love my muffins, yes. So now it's finally time to come to something concrete. I'm going to design and forge a foot peg for my bike. For starter, I designed the shape using a graphic software. To help me get inspired, I queued up a couple of episodes of Metalocalypse, the best metal cartoon ever! In the end, I've decided to go for the Maltese cross and a double-sided brass knuckle shape. Once ready, I printed them out on paper and I brought it to the shop to start working on the mold. But let's take a step back and check out what we're going to do. I'm going to transfer the design onto a piece of polystyrene and I will cut it out so that I can have a three-dimensional shape of the design. Then, using the same foam, I'm going to make a channel for the liquid metal to flow through and reach every part of the shape. Finally, I will bury the two pieces together under some sand. Once the dirt is nicely packed, I will pour the molten aluminum. The heat will instantaneously vaporize the foam and the metal will take its place inside the sand mold. And if everything goes well, we'll end up with some crazy new pieces. So, in order to create the polystyrene mold, I need to use one of those heated wire cutters we used to play with when we were kids. I found this one on eBay for about 15 euros. I also bought some extra wire, so if it breaks, I have the replacement. As for the polystyrene, I bought this construction insulating board for about 3 euros. After plugging it in, the wire will heat up and it will cut through the board like a knife through butter. But while I wait, I will transfer the paper shape onto the board. For cutting the paper, I suggest to use an X-Acto knife with a long blade. It will make the job of following the line so much easier than with scissors, and the inside holes will be a breeze. The cutter comes with a bunch of different attachments and I decide to test the long tip to cut out the portion of the board that I will use for cutting the two designs. This board is pretty dense compared to the packing polystyrene I'm used to, but it seems to cut very well. Now I need to transfer the shapes from the paper to the board. I once again remember of when I used to cut polystyrene as a kid, preparing the figurines for the Christmas scenery. Well, looking at the result, I've got to say that I've gotten pretty sloppy with time. But I hope to make it up with the forging part of this project. So, let's keep pushing ahead. The two pieces of foam board are ready for the precision cutting. I swap the cutter tip with the wire attachment and I secure it to the bench clamp. I'm going to move the piece around following the lines. I feel that this way I will have better control of the cut. The perimeter is done. Now, by switching the cutter attachment again, I can make a starter hole to do the inside cut. Once I have the hole, I can use the wire attachment once again. To get it in position is enough to squeeze a little bit the holding fork to release one end of the wire, and then it can be inserted into the hole and then hooked up again. Before doing this, make sure the wire is cold. Powering up the cutter, I can now do the inside cut of the design. By squeezing and releasing the wire from the fork, the piece is now done. For the second shape, I do the same process as the first. After a little practice, I've already gotten much better at it. It's important to keep a continuous movement to achieve a straight cut. Just like before, I keep cutting the inside holes by unhooking and threading through the wire. This piece is a little bit more laborious, but I'm sure it's worth it. Of course I'm gonna write Chaz on it, and yes, I do have ego issues. I like to clean up the mold at this point because it's much easier now rather than later when the object will be made out of metal. The foam cleans up very quickly, and I use a sandpaper-covered hand file to shape the inside faces. I think that the shapes are good enough for this project, and I can proceed with creating the channel that will take the molten metal under the sand into the mold. To be sure there will be an equal distribution of material throughout the piece, I'm splitting the channel to lead straight onto two different points of the mold. With one single point of entry, the molten aluminium would take too long to flow all the way around the mold, with the risk of cooling off before filling the entire space. Once ready, the channel is attached to the shape with some glue. I hope it will hold the pressure of the sand. The glue needs to dry, so I decide to prepare the bucket for the pour. It needs to be tall enough to cover the mold with sand, but not much more, or it will interfere with the crucible. The bottom of the bucket needs to be filled with sand, enough to protect the plastic from the heat. Then the mold finally goes in. This refractory mortar is very, very fine, so it should be able to recreate very fine details. But I have to make sure that every hole is properly filled. Once totally covered with sand, I need to reveal the channel and create a little crater around it. This will help direct the liquid metal straight into the channel. A bit of water helps keeping everything in place. I'm very excited. I'm about to melt metal and forge my own piece. I mean, this is very cool. I'm going to use some construction sand as the base for the bracket, just in case of catastrophic fail. And now I can spark up the forge. But before doing so, please let me take a second to thank you all for the support that you demonstrate every day by hitting the like button, by sharing our videos on your social networks, and by subscribing to our channel. Now you can click on the little bell to receive a notification of when I publish a new video so that you can see it as soon as it's out. If you'd like, you can also visit our site called www.romacustombike.com, where you can find all our unique accessories and our t-shirts, because nothing is better than posting in the real world. Look at that fire, almost burning my very costly camera. But who cares? The experience will be worth the cost. Plus, I have to say that I've been able to definitely refine the system. Now everything is a bit more efficient, and with the crucible in place, we are ready to go. In just 5 minutes, the forge is at temperature, and I can enjoy the very fun part of dropping stuff in the pit of hell. All right, I think I'm ready for the very climactic moment of actually forging the metal. This is it. Let's find out if we got a yay or a nay.
I can't freaking believe that it worked! There you go, proof!
This is incredible! I'm so happy it worked, you guys! I'm freaking out because the first failure was such a bummer, but this worked! I'm so excited!
Metal! Oh.
Now I need to remove the channel. A handsaw is just the tool for the job.
I look outside, the window is raining now. The colors fade like running water.
The Maltese cross is ready, and it looks like it all worked out. But will I be able to replicate the success with the second mold, the double-sided brass knuckle? The process is the same as for the first piece, so we'll fast forward straight to the fun part, the pouring of the molten metal. Everything looks better in slow motion, especially stuff that already looks good at natural speed. I'm pretty optimistic about the second round, but the proof is in the pudding. Unfortunately, this didn't go so well. The narrow passages and the design of the channels determined this failure. You can see that at the edges of the mold, the different flows of metal have cooled off before they manage to meet and fuse together. Too bad, but a good lesson nonetheless. On the other hand, the cross came out awesome. So let's clean it up and file it down to get it ready for installation. Once clamped to the bench, the main concern are the two spots where the channels were cut off. With a good file and a bit of work, they're taken care of. With a wire brush, I clean the cross from the sand and any other impurities while retaining the full look of a molten object.
Oh, I wish the wind could matter.
there they are, all the parts I've created during this three-part episode coming together for creating a unique piece for my bike. If this ain't love, I don't know what love is. Now, all I need to do is to find a spot where to make a couple of holes to allow a screw to pass through my freshly made footboard. After measuring the right length, a threaded rod quickly becomes the fastener to secure the footboard to the support I made in a previous episode. If you'd like to see it, check the description for the link. All the different parts are in place. A bit of thread lock will make sure I don't lose it while driving. And there it is. The footboard for my kid is ready. It looks pretty cool, especially knowing what went into it. It quickly finds its place on the bike, and I'm sure it will be comfortable too. You guys, you have no idea how happy I am for the results of this project. And what do you think? Let me know by visiting my Facebook page called Roma Custom Bike ENG, or by commenting right here on YouTube. If you have missed the first two parts of this project, make sure you check them out. You can find the link in the description. Remember to subscribe and ring the bell to get notification. If you'd like, you can also visit our site called www.romacustombike.com to find the accessories we've been producing and our t-shirt. That's it for now. I'm Custom Chess for Roma Custom Bike, and I'll see you next time. We'll be right back.